Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the IMAT co-chairs and program committee for the honour of delivering this keynote talk. I intend to hit some hot buttons. I will use this platform to push opinions and bring about an informed discussion. Before we go too far, it is usual in Australia to acknowledge the original people of our wonderful country. We respectfully acknowledge the Wurundjeri people and their elders past and present, who are the traditional owners of the land on which Swinburne's Australian campuses are located in Melbourne's east and outer east. We are honoured to recognise our connections to Wurundjeri country, history, culture and spirituality through these locations, and strive to ensure that we operate in a manner that respects and honours the elders and ancestors of this land. The world is experiencing a pandemic. This presentation is dedicated to the healthcare staff and essential service personnel who are working at the front line of this 2020 global pandemic. Their devotion and dedication is inspirational. We are all stronger when we work together. Thank you. Like any organized story or thesis, there are chapters. The sequencing of my slides is a progression through technical readiness levels, TRLs, that go from 2 to 8. In brief, a low TRL number represents a science focus, and as we progress through the numbers to TRL 8, there is a transition from science to real-world applications. That is, at TRL 8, a company can send out invoices for their manufactured product. The stage is set, so let us start. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder, attributed to Plato, and a statement that can be argued intensely. Here are some truly beautiful microstructures from the website and calendars of George F. Vanderwart. Wonderful images for everyone, regardless of your background. For the material scientist, the beauty goes much deeper, because you can explore phase transitions, grain boundary behavior, and a host of amazing physical metallurgical artifacts. I encourage you to ask your workmates and even your children to explore websites such as those of George. This would be their entry into the fascinating world of material science, where we begin to understand deep science. I'm also unashamedly going to give a plug for the CAMS 2021 conference, which will be held in Melbourne in December of 2021. Escape your Northern Hemisphere winter and visit us. One of the hot buttons for thermal spray is microstructure, where the adjective ugly is often used rather than beautiful. Here is an important note if you are chasing money. An ugly microstructure does not resonate well with funding agencies. We have all experienced presenting micrographs to a potential sponsor who is new to thermal spray. We need to lock the doors before the presentation so they do not flee in terror when they see a material full of defects. The main point is that these complex microstructures are employed in a host of low and high performance applications, and this list is growing every day. The micrographs shown in slide 6 are of functional coatings. They exhibit a lamellar morphology, a rugged surface, a rugged interface against the substrate, as well as porosity, cracks, and many other artifacts. They are the ugly duckling of materials engineering. But as you become more mature in understanding their exotic microstructure, then the world of beautiful functionalities is revealed. I have two more examples. This is a beautiful slide according to anyone's taste. It shows chromium nickel fibers embedded in a nickel chromium aluminium silicon matrix that has been sequentially thermally sprayed. The typical lamellar microstructure of the matrix material is quite distinctive. The technological beauty is that near net shape manufacturing of metal matrix composites can be established. The engineering beauty is that we can create special functional properties by using thermal spray processing, just like the toolbox on a Swiss Army knife. A further example is attributed to the complex structures manufactured by using thermal spray to form solid oxide fuel cells. This is an additive manufacturing technique in its most pure form, where we have a nickel iterostabilized zirconia bottom material, an intermediate iterostabilized zirconia electrolyte, and then the perovskite cathode as the top layer. In fact, thermal spray has been ahead of additive manufacturing before additive manufacturing became a buzzword. I was tempted during my preparation for this talk to provide a list of applications of images. Such an approach is not my intent. The purpose of this delivery is to convince you that there is a better way to design every coating to make it fit for purpose. The science of thermal spray is multifaceted and becomes deep in specialized disciplines. What you think you are getting is not what you actually produce. So let me explain. The physical properties of thermal spray coatings are extrinsic in nature. To state this another way, you cannot go to a data book, find the modulus or thermal conductivity of material, say alumina, and expect the thermal spray coating to exhibit the same properties. This point is best illustrated by reference to the well-known diagrams of Ashby, where he has plotted thermal conductivity with regards to thermal expansion. Thermally sprayed zirconia has an extrinsic thermal conductivity of 1 watt per meter Kelvin, whereas bulk zirconia has a value of 2 watts per meter Kelvin. The thermal conductivity of zirconia has been halved just because we have created a unique extrinsic microstructure. This singular data point has spawned a multi-billion dollar industry in thermal spray coatings. So, what you see may not be what you get in terms of performance because there is beauty in forming non-equilibrium phases where we can question the Gibbs phase rules. The rapid solidification gives rise to a host of thermodynamic behaviors that require sophisticated measurements. And I am compelled to point you towards our journal, the Journal of Thermal Spray Technology, that champions all areas of thermal spray. Have this on your coffee table or in your iPad. Thermal spray is often focused on mimicking the microstructure of bulk materials. This is a mistake because the material properties of the thermal spray coating can be designed to be unlike those of the original feedstock. This opens the door for materials that have a bespoke architecture that displays specific attributes. This bronze coating illustrates some of these artifacts. These are typical for the majority of thermal spray coatings manufactured by two-wire arc, plasma and flame spray, as well as HVOF processes. Some thermal spray processes also typically produce dense coatings, where the microstructure is more like the bulk coating. However, the additional feature is that of residual stress effects. Coating structures are complex. Here are two bioceramic coatings for orthopedic implants. First of all, there are two cautions. The first one is that these are 2D images of a 3D structure. And the second caution is that metallographic preparation is an art, where the sample preparation deeply influences what you see. Now, here is a question. Which of these coatings is most desirable for the application of being located on an orthopedic implant? So now the engineer, the bioengineer, needs to specify design criteria, and this is the initial stumbling block. The ASTM standard specification F1609 designed in 2014, provides guidelines for the chemical requirements, physical characterization, and mechanical characterization. The porosity indicating these two coatings constitute attributes because they enable good interaction between the coating and the physiological media within a 3D environment. The different shades of grey represent different phases, which exhibit different dissolution rates within physiological media. Hence, the biological interaction between the implant and the body can be controlled for optimum patient outcomes. A generic cartoon of a thermal spray coating sets the initial baseline that illustrates the substrate, metal bond coat, and ceramic overlay. The bond coat is usually 50 to 100 micrometers thick, and the ceramic overlay can be 200 to 300 micrometers thick. It is indicated that grit blasting can become embedded within the substrate surface, and that over grit blasting is detrimental. These are the features labelled as 1 and 2, and some typical roughness values are presented for the grit blasted substrate and the surface coating. I would now like to introduce the phrase defect taxonomy. Taxonomy refers to the science of naming, describing, and classifying classes or objects. For example, the taxonomy of plants, insects, and mammals. It is convenient to use this to now classify the defect nature of thermal spray coatings. Slide 15 shows features that arise from feedstock particles that can be fully melted to form disc splats, partially melted, or not melt at all. The degree of melting is known as the Majewski criteria. It is defined as the splat aspect ratio. Thus, we now have solid metrics that can be applied to define the taxonomic features. Or some of the particles may be overheated and form oxides, or some of the particles may bounce up from the substrate, resolidify, and become inclusions. Other defects arise due to the packing of particles and physical interactions, much in the same manner as squeezing grapes in a jar. For instance, interlamellar pores can form, or gas evolution from supersaturated solutions form intralamellar pores. And cracks evolve during and after spray process due to the high energy impacts and stress relief. The beauty of thermal spray coatings lies in this rich microstructure. I describe these microstructures as being chaotic, which is a mathematically more rigorous description than defective architectures. It becomes apparent that it can be rightly claimed that thermal spray coatings are the original nanomaterial, the original composite material, a factory grade material, the original example of additive manufacturing, and many other materials engineering firsts. Thermal spray provides opportunities because of this special microstructure. You will see this slide a few more times. The main take-home messages are: 1. The microstructure of a thermal spray coating is complex, and 2. The components of the microstructure can be classified in taxonomy jargon. The missing link is putting numbers and morphologies behind these microstructural features, and this is a grand challenge for our community. The fine detail of splat microstructures, documented at Limoges and other universities, indicates that macroscopic splat behavior and microscopic grain growth is determined by the processing environment. Note that I've used the passive expression determined by the processing environment, and not the more active phrase controlled by the processing environment. Ultimately, we must be quite aggressive in controlling the structure that we want, and I will address this topic in a little while. And yes, splats give us a great deal of enjoyment and fun. Exacting microscopy has verified that metallurgical bonding does arise across the interface in certain situations. Scientific results such as these allow links between processing and properties to become better understood. Let me briefly consider the co-spraying of iterostabilized zirconia fibers in conjunction with an alumina powder. The objective is to form a fiber-reinforced ceramic composite. It all starts with the feedstock processing, and the cartoon at the lower left corner shows the iterostabilized zirconia fibers encased in the lower melting point alumina so that a football-shaped feedstock can be fed to the processing tool. Under high magnification, we can detect columnar growth of the alumina matrix, iterozirconia fiber cracking, as well as decohesion of the matrix from the fiber. As a side note, this example points to the fact that all thermal sprayers eventually, turn into powder technologists, since this is the foundation of thermal spray. So far, I've been addressing the science, TRL 2 and 3. This interim summary sets the scene for transitioning towards high TRLs where there are revenue-producing applications. For many of you, I have reinforced prior knowledge, but I've also aimed at opening an extra dimension by looking at processing needs and controls. Therefore, we must understand the how and why of defect taxonomy of thermal spray coatings. We know that the science is fascinating and the great unknown. We are exploring new frontiers, just like Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock. I also hope that I've convinced you that thermal spray coating microstructures are very, very beautiful. However, we need to ask some serious questions if we want to head towards TRL 7 and 8. For instance, who is the real customer and what do they want? Let me back up just a little. Some of you may recall a robust discussion that was initiated by the late Doug Harris during his plenary talk at an international thermal spray conference in the previous century. He challenged the interactions and business relationships between the equipment and feedstock suppliers and their customers. Doug, as a customer, expressed his strong opinions about what he perceived as a one-way relationship. I'm now going down a similar path, but from a different angle. My direction is, how do scientists at TRL 2 and 4 relate to manufacturing industries who operate at TRLs 7 to 8? This is the so-called Valley of Death at 2RL 5 and 6, and how this is navigated during prototyping and pilot studies. And by the way, the theme of beautiful microstructures carries over, as you will see. Hence, the question is again, for the second time, who is the real customer and what do they want? The answer is simple. Industry must be sustainable, which is a polite way of saying they must make money. A consumer such as a large manufacturing company is not compelled to use any surface engineering method. Often, it is perceived as too complex and adding cost. There are many variables. There are many variables, as this complex fishbone diagram shows for thermal spray manufacturing, where there are at least 8 major steps. I'm not going to go through all of these many variables that influence coating qualification and applications. The reality is that, one, industry must progress from the torch to the application as soon as possible, and the value proposition must be identified to the manufacturer. My experience is that there is limited interest from industry in the process, the structure, or the science. They are more focused on pragmatic outcomes. So how can thermal spray, or in fact, any engineering technology, jump this technological valley of death? The answer is that industry should be very interested in the fine detail of the process because all of the beautiful microstructural artifacts, if controlled, add tremendous value. The table lists some cause-effect relationships where the cause is the process tool and the effect is the influence on the coating microstructure. The microstructure is now a feature that a material scientist can deploy to create unique properties. Thermal spray processing is a Swiss Army knife of surface engineering. A simple example is that for ID2, an increase in the velocity leads to a more fine microstructure and higher density. As well, for ID6, an increase in the standoff distance will influence the temperature and velocity and hence splat cohesion. This is not rocket science. A small footnote is that the generic description of a thermal spray torch can now be expressed in the positive phrase of process tool. This reasoning can now be referred to the blue cells in this table. Now we define the most desirable microstructure and then select the best tool for its creation. So let us recall a previous slide where the rich structure of coatings was presented. These microstructural artifacts can now be assigned to specific processing conditions, and these artifacts control material properties. This is the exquisite palette that we have available as materials engineers to design the architecture of coatings. The features in the microstructure are identified and assigned to a classification according to taxonomy principles. The root cause for the formation of the feature is embedded within a tool, and then there is an outcome with regards to the material properties. One of the first big picture views is therefore to integrate the science with the technology for an engineering outcome. The science in the blue boxes at the top is defined within the three regions that can be controlled: before spraying, during spraying, and after spraying. These three process regions are integrated with three engineering criteria shown in the orange boxes at the bottom: the feedstock quality, the thermal spray parameters, and the surface preparation of the component. Within a production environment, these concepts are embedded in technical manuals and are often described as spray tables. These document the state of the art and are highly confidential. If there are issues on the shop floor, then the technician and engineer will use their experiences to troubleshoot their way out of the problem. You will never see this type of flowchart within the procedures manual of any company because it oversimplifies a complex array of instrument interactions. Focus though on the blue boxes, where we go back to go, just like a Monopoly board game. These iterations cost money. If these are reduced, then the profit margin increases. Keep the following thought in mind. How can science optimize the learning process for spray tables? How can we make shortcuts? I will address these questions in a little while. Now let us refocus and talk about the future. Einstein said, "A ship is always safe at the shore, but that is not what it is built for." Let me paraphrase this quote. If you want 100% assurance of the outcome, then do nothing. And the cartoon states, innovate. No, we already tried that once. It didn't work out. Of course, there is risk in exploring new materials or new drugs in our current climate, but the outcomes of success can be enormous. I would point you towards bond coats, thermal barrier coatings, electronic applications, and biomedical services, all of which have multi-billion dollar markets. Remember that it can take 10 to 15 years for innovation to gain traction from initial conception to consumer uptake. This is a serious commitment that requires continual pushing, trust, faith, and resources. This is the polite form of saying we need cold, hard cash. My first example concerns high entropy alloys, or HEAs. HEAs consist of a cocktail of at least five elements that are in approximately equimolar proportions. For example, the elements aluminium, cobalt, chromium, iron, nickel, titanium, and magnesium are common elements. There are four references that I'd like you to refer to. I am proud to note that Swinburne were among the first to focus on thermal spraying of HEAs in 2014 in collaboration with colleagues from the INI Institute of Technology in Madras and in Hyderabad. The attributes of HEAs are, in summary, they weigh less, they exhibit excellent high temperature properties while retaining good mechanical properties, and the constituents cost less. I refer you to these formal manuscripts and this excellent book for more details. Recall the theme of this presentation, beautiful microstructures. Is this microstructure beautiful? I now remind you of the previous slide in the lower left-hand corner. The process envelope creates composites of splats that exhibit distinct features. The splats range from oxides, shown at the bottom, to grey contrast, which are of the alloy with the whitest contrast. This effort is at TRL4, where we are navigating the Valley of Death. These splat structures and their chemistries reflect the dynamic splat behaviour and the complex chemistries within HEAs. These will now be interrogated just a little bit further to expand our knowledge and understanding. The pictorial table lists the splat mechanisms of splat formation at impact under two controls. We're controlling the particle size from small to medium to large, and we're controlling the temperature regimes from low to intermediate to high at the formation of impact. All of the details of this table are presented in a recent manuscript by Anupam et al. I will present the overarching knowledge and understanding. The cell indicated as the green circle indicates small particles at low temperatures, but they do not deposit but may form surface oxides. Their tendency is to oxidize and adhere as the temperature increases to medium and high. So there is a progression from 3 to 2 to 1, where we're getting more likelihood of adhesion, but also more likelihood of oxidation. On the other hand, large particles, as shown on the right-hand side of the diagram, show that the HEA material composition is more likely to be retained. They can still rebound at low temperatures. However, they can also form oxides at the higher temperatures. The point is that this beautiful microstructure can be explained in terms of thermal spray processing, which I have described as our Swiss Army knife. Another exciting area revolves around antimicrobial coatings. Implants can suffer from poor mechanical properties and high risk of infection, as indicated in the green textbook. The question is, can the surfaces of such implants be engineered to repel microbes or kill them outright? Thus, the cartoons on the bottom right-hand orange panel provide some guidance. For example, how can the surface of a thermal spray coating be designed to repel microbes? Or can we design them to actually pierce microbes? Or can the microstructures incorporate porosity that hold an agent to improve cell growth and or release a biocide that kills bacteria? So the design outcome and the design criteria amount to the following: improved mechanical properties, enhanced biocompatibility, and intrinsic antimicrobial properties. A previous slide demonstrated two bioceramic materials, one based on a zirconium silicate and the other on a phosphate. Both of these beautiful microstructures are functional bioceramics, but only hydroxyapatite is currently in use. Now I will provide some more details. We have carried out extreme property mapping by nano indentation on the cross section of these coatings. The 20 by 20 matrix of indents allows contour maps of the elastic modulus to be overlaid onto the microstructure. Three of these indents are identified as red circles, but there are 400 of these for each material, and there are replicate runs. The bagdotite material exhibits a greater modulus. as well as less variability than the hydroxyapatite. As well, the mechanical property measurements are correlated to the phases within the microstructure, as can be identified by the blue rendition for the hydroxyapatite coating that reveals a low modulus phase. Both of these surfaces are inductive to cell attachment and proliferation, which again demonstrates the relationship between surface texture and nature to bioactive functionality. The red arrows indicate cells bridging lamellae features and is indicative of a good short-term outcome. All of these are positive results and indicate that the subunits within the microstructure are performing as they are designed. Finally, the coating must be applied to an orthopedic device. Remember from the previous slide that we have instigated the comprehensive troubleshooting pathway to get to this stage, as repeated in the green box. There are five stages. 1. The implant is measured and this data input into a graphics program. 2. Make a plastic mock-up of the clamshell masks so that the coating will be deposited only onto specified surfaces. 3. Make up a metal clamshell mask by conventional additive manufacturing. 4. Masking the implant. 5. Spraying the bioceramic coating onto the implant. Therefore, the desirable microstructure has been precisely located on the orthopedic appliance to manufacture the functional coating. This is an achievement at TRL6. The next example explores coatings for high-speed flights in excess of Mach 5. This is about 6,000 kilometers an hour or 3,800 miles per hour. It would take less than 1 hour to travel from London to New York. At this speed, the leading edge of the vehicle gets extremely hot due to the high enthalpy bow shock, and the surface temperature exceeds 2,000 degrees centigrade. This is about 3,600 degrees Fahrenheit. The thermal protection system must survive high temperatures, and like a thermal barrier coating, must conduct heat away from the leading edge. I repeat, the engineering specification is high thermal conductivity, which implies that the microstructural design be a dense coating. Thus, the design criteria for a TPS is very different from that of a thermal barrier coating. A thermal barrier coating requires low thermal conductivity and be porous, which is converse to the requirements of the TPS. The preferable materials of choice for a thermal protection system are restricted to high conductivity and high melting point materials, which leads us towards zirconium and hafnium diborides. There are many challenges to form boride-based coatings, both technical and scientific. One is to modify existing feedstocks so that they can be sprayed. The second hurdle is to have processing conditions that exclude oxygen. And finally, the phase equilibria is complex and difficult to resolve. Some of our early coatings consisted of a three-layer design, with zirconium diboride being overlaid with mullite and then a top coat of partially stabilized zirconia. The hardness data provided some confidence that coatings of some quality were being manufactured, but the remaining issue of excessive porosity still remains. Our work can be discriminated from that of other groups since we are working with pure boride materials rather than composite strategies that incorporate either molydisilicide or silicon carbide. More recent work has focused on moving to hafnium diboride sprayed onto carbon-carbon substrates. This has been much more challenging, and the microstructures, while not especially pretty, still demonstrate great promise. Our practice, in common with all universities, is to use simple substrates initially, for example, mild steel or stainless, as shown in figures A and B. Then, when we feel more comfortable with the range of spray parameters, we work towards more complex materials such as the hafnium diboride and substrates such as carbon-carbon. The extreme property mapping in the orange center panel shows how hard and soft regions can be identified and related to the microstructure. Hence, the composite structural analysis can be carried out. The wire ball plots on the right-hand panel show that these coatings consist of several families with larger populations. This approach integrates the microstructural data with the phase analysis and mechanical properties. My remaining 8 slides have 2 objectives. First, I want to tie together the preceding discussion. And the second, I want to be able to connect all of these dots as best as I can to forecast the future. The reality of the thermal spray process is that it is either hit or miss, since the processing envelope is highly variable in terms of temperature and velocity. And, as well, this technology deals with particle size distributions. These frames from a high-speed video recorder show moly particles being frozen in time. These particles either enter the flux, as shown in A and D, or they can miss it entirely, as shown in frames B and C. Thus, the molten state will mirror this hit or miss behavior. Remember the taxonomy table that was described as an exquisite palette where we can use our Swiss Army knife. This is shown again here, but now focused on the top orange box, which summarizes the interrelationships. The structure evolves from microfeatures. The processing tool represents traditional spray tables. Together, these establish materials properties that lead to special functionalities, application, and revenue. So let me put it this way. Structure plus process equals property, which together provide economic drivers. So thermal spray, as the original additive technology, has strong credentials as a disruptive technology. But the shortcoming is how to get from A to C and survive the valley of death. The valley of death can be thought of as the progression from TRL1 to TRL9. The traditional spray and pray approach extends the valley of death. It is a trial and error approach that is highly inefficient, as indicated by the scattered arrows on the target. The more modern approach is to use the emerging tools to hit the target of focus. I'm terming this as smart spray. The bridge between TRL3 to TRL7 is now replaced by smart spray, where we have online control. Online control is not new in manufacturing. It has not been implemented widely for thermal spray due to the many stochastic variables. The bridge needs 3 prime inputs: a fundamental understanding of splats, diagnostic devices, and feedback control loops. The outcomes are all derived by a high-level integration with the industrial Internet of Things to create digital twins of the spray process. The next slide puts these elements together. The future is a dream that is gathering substance and momentum. The top two rows are achievable right now, but the cost is prohibitive. All of the physical inputs and outputs can be measured. This is the top row. The process variables in the middle row can also be measured. The challenge is the bottom row. Here, the objective is to integrate all of the knowledge and understanding, and this is smart. The blue hatched text boxes describe the deep knowledge needed. 1. We need the torch physics and particle properties. 2. We need the offline and online parameters. And 3, we need a taxonomy, property relationship databases. And as you can see, the value of death is always lurking in the background. I do have two summary slides, but first I would like to use this once in a lifetime opportunity where I am presenting to a global audience to give thanks to the many people who have contributed to my professional growth. I only wish that these colleagues were still here so that they were well aware of their strong influence on me. And I want to encourage and nurture future generations of surface engineers to mimic the high standards of these individuals who have passed away. And I've listed some of the people who I'm currently working with who will hold the torch in the future. I would now like to summarise my talk. First of all, we know a lot about technology. We are all explorers on new frontiers of science. Secondly, thermal spray equipment is versatile and can be considered as a processing tool, just like a Swiss Army knife. The microstructure can be designed to suit the need. The microstructure is a palette of artifacts that can be mixed and matched for functionality. Four, processing conditions can be controlled to hit the microstructural target. And finally, intelligent design or spray smart will work hand in hand with digital twins to accelerate manufacturing. In summary, the traditional spray and pray conservative mindset must be set aside. Future generations of surface engineering will be propelled by key learnings that are based on understanding the deep science and technology. The final slide is a pictorial summary. 1. We have a far-reaching vision that is exploring new frontiers. 2. We have a toolkit. We have a toolkit to process materials. 3. We have a microstructural palette. 4. We have spray smart target. 5. The microstructural elements are the building blocks that enable creativity. And finally, thermal spray is proud to be the ugly duckling of manufacturing because we create very, very beautiful and special microstructures. Thank you very much.